My name's Lloyd Russell-Moyle. I'm the Member of Parliament for Brighton, Kempton and Peacehaven, and I was born in Brighton and I grew up in Lewes, a town 5 miles away. My mum was a teacher and my dad was an engineer. We were not a party political family, but we were political. Where arguments in the evening about political issues were common, you know, kind of everyone said we had a fiery household. It was the kind of house where you had to speak up if you wanted to be heard. No one was going to wait for you to listen. The same with food, you know, kind of if you wanted to eat it, you had to grab it quickly, otherwise someone else would eat it off your plate. There was a strong connection with family and a strong connection with community, you know, and in Lewes that continued. I was sent to the Woodcraft Folk, which was a children's organisation in the town. And when I was about 13, 14, the leader decided not to do it anymore. And I remember with my parents and myself and a few other people our age, we said, well, why don't we kind of semi-organise it ourselves? We would put together the timetable. We would sit down and try and organise the activities and events, think about what we wanted to do. So that's where I took more of a leadership role. And that summer, the Woodcraft Folk organised a big international camp in Nottingham of about 4,000 people from around the UK. And I wanted to go. And a few of us wanted to go, but not enough to go from Lewes only. So we got together with the Brighton groups and we agreed to go up with the Brighton group. And we went up to Nottingham, where we took part in the camp, and it was themed sustainable development. At the end of that camp, all the kids got together and we worked on this kind of manifesto of what we wanted the world to be like. We were on news round, and you know, kind of very exciting it was. Being 14, 15, coming up with this manifesto of what you wanted. John Prescott signed it off, Deputy Prime Minister, all that kind of thing. And we finished it and we kind of said, a group of us, what do we do with this now? We've done this, it's really exciting. So we said, well, next year there's a UN conference. Why don't we organise to send 10 young people to this UN conference? That was the change for me from like group leader stuff, Woodcraft Folk stuff, and kind of a more political internationalist, of course, kind of edge of we're trying to shape the agreements. Now, if I look back, did we probably shape the agreements? I don't know if we did, you know, kind of, I think we managed to make a few words different. Was it a really fascinating experience bumping into Robert Mugabe and Tony Blair and Dick Cheney and walking out of Dick Cheney speaking and being, you know, raising banners and being dragged out of the hall and all these things? It gave me a political kind of edge, and it gave me, I think, my grounding of understanding of how political change happens. You have to have people that bridge those protest movements on the street and people who can be in the conference hall. And it's not that we can just have the protest movements directing and deciding policy. We can't just have the mob on the street, you know, kind of, because there's no real organisation, because there's no kind of negotiation that happens there. But equally, you can't just have the people in the hall totally oblivious to what the people on the streets and the people in those movements are thinking. Sexuality, to me, has never been something that I've really questioned. In the sense of, as soon as I knew it was gay, I knew that that's what I was, if you understand what I mean. Before I knew what gay really meant, I had heard the word gay, of course, sometimes in the playground, but no one really knew what it meant. It was just kind of a word. A lot of the girls were my friends, in that sense, and the boys were my desire. And that was at primary school, so it was a very, and I didn't really know the term gay at that point. You know, at secondary school, it becomes a bit harder because everyone else starts to get a consciousness of what gay is, and that it is something that maybe you shouldn't want to be. For me, the challenge was never internally, am I gay or not? Is this right or wrong? I never had a feeling that it was wrong. I mean, my parents had just brought me up that it was perfectly acceptable, whatever you wanted to be, you know? But that other people were being distilled that it wasn't quite right. And there was no real positive kind of, there was no ability for teachers to positively correct And that is, I think, the big problem with Section 28. It's not that teachers were there to tell us hostily, you can't be gay, but it's that the other children could come into the school and spread myth and rumour and lie and nastiness about gay people, and teachers couldn't correct it. You couldn't educate that out. So it just, that was the status, was the lowest common denominator of hate and misery. So Section 28 was a law that made it illegal for anyone in public service to talk positively or promote homosexuality. The law was introduced actually because the country was making great strides forward, and local authority in London, ILEA, which was the education authority in the centre of London, produced a very boring book.
Controversy has surrounded the book for almost a year. Its intention is to show that relationships between those of the same sex are as valid as those between members of the opposite sex, and the effect on children is discussed too.
Thatcher hit the roof. And Thatcher was also playing this culture war at the time.
Children who need to be taught to respect traditional moral values are being taught that they have an inalienable right to be gay.
So it was all the height of the 80s culture wars, and Thatcher thought this was a great thing to distinguish between Labour and the rest of the country. So she introduced Section 28. It was never used. Never once was a teacher or a health professional ever prosecuted. So some could say, well, it didn't really then exist. If you never enforced it, you could have said and did what you want. The problem was it provided a huge chilling effect. It meant that no material could be produced officially by a school, and I don't think any schools really did, produced by a school that talked about homosexuality, unless you talked about it in a demonising way. AIDS is coming to kill you.
There is no known cure. The virus can be passed during sexual intercourse with an infected person. Anyone can get it, man or woman. So far, it's been confined to small groups, but it's spreading.
So there was those messages. They were allowed. It wasn't that you weren't allowed to talk about homosexuality. It was that you weren't allowed to talk about it in a positive, affirming way. So even more pernicious than not talking at all. You can talk, but only if you're scaring the EBGBs out of the kids. And so how that practiced in a school like Lewis, next to Brighton, liberal, open, is that, of course, I didn't really feel that the teachers were homophobic, damning you, all that kind of thing, but they just weren't able to positively talk about different relationships and role models. And on an individual level, teachers were always great. You know, I suspect most teachers kind of knew, you know, kind of one way or another. And actually, I remember in my last year of secondary school, before Section 28 had been lifted, the school counsellor having a few sessions with me. And she helped me and she supported me. And she could do that under Section 28, if you push the boat out a little bit. But what she couldn't have done is gone into the classroom or gone into the other teachers and said, look, we need to do some education here to support this. And that was completely lacking. And so it wasn't a miserable time at school, although I didn't really enjoy my first few years at secondary school. And by the end, I'd got a group of friends who I knew. By the end of secondary school, I got drunk and declared my love to one of my friends that it was straight, and it was all out in the school, and it was what it was. So I was early out of the door, probably because I got too drunk and declared my love. But actually, it was quite useful because it got it out of the way. And that has been my approach in life. Get it out of the way if people can know. And then if people know, then they can't harm you. It was surprising how the party at that point didn't believe it could win anywhere. The party at that point believed it was on a lose-lose strategy. And that's not where the zeitgeist was. There was a coalition building of people who said that we wanted change here in Brighton. So I immediately knew that there was some real chance that we could win, and it was going to be close. But the party didn't see that. Trade unions came to help us, local trade unions, the local GMB, said, okay, what do you need? We'll get you a car. They got us a car. What do you need? You need telephones. The GMB arranged to wire this building up overnight and put telephones so we could do telephone banking here. The GMB came forward and did that. The Fire Brigade Union, which is the building that we're in, said, yeah, go into our offices, use the building straight away. They were unwavering in their commitment. But that is what the Labour Party is. The Labour Party is not, and should never be, and the problem is it has become sometimes, a party that is directed from party headquarters. My view is the Labour Party, in its best and when it wins, is a coalition of the Labour movement, of left liberals, and of socialist Christians and socialist Muslims as well, you know, kind of socialist religious people who come together to form this coalition. And that's where it worked. And when you have too much control from the nation, it doesn't, from the national office, it doesn't work. So actually, it might well have been, I can't tell you this for sure, but it might well have been a godsend that the National Party didn't interfere much. I think the two national leaflets that the National Party put out were the two weakest leaflets we put out in the whole campaign. I still thank them for it, but they still charged us. When you come in, you're part of a large group and the public eye is not great. But as you get picked off one by one, the right-wing media take their turns. Keir got elected, I was appointed his environment minister, and they just went one thing after another thing. And they'd done things like that under Jeremy, but it'd just be kind of one thing moved on. But they organised it and they said to the Leeds office, we've got more, we're going to leak something out every week until he goes. They said that, that's what they said. And but not just on me, on my staff. They'd have people sitting outside the salon of my ex-boyfriend to find out dirt on him. That's what they did. If someone writes to me and says something abusive in writing, well, okay, it doesn't really harm me. However, when that turns to either personal kind of attacks, kind of in the street when you're walking down the street, people shouting at things, that is intimidating. And that did happen during some of the Brexit furore. And that's why now, you know, when the Sun printed a picture of my house and a big arrow to my bedroom window, the parliamentary authorities said, God, this has now put you in danger. We'll have to replace your windows with reinforced windows. And that was difficult. And what then happened is the right-wing media particularly, the tittle-tattle media, decided that I was their next target to try and get rid of out of the shadow cabinet. They couldn't quite find enough on me. They couldn't quite prove that I was, you know, whatever horrible person they thought I should be. So they started digging in the private lives of some of my staff members. The problem is that that is in the media against their name as well as my name, and it affects their future and their job and their family. And I get elected and I get paid good enough to be able to take some of that. And I have some security, actually. If I lose my seat tomorrow, it'll be sad, but I could go back to living a relatively humble, normal life in my little house and I'll get on with it. It'll be much harder for them because they can't defend themselves. They can't speak out. They can't tell their side of the story. So that was particularly unpleasant part of the campaign where people were trying to go after individual staff members that worked for me. But also, there was, I'm afraid, a lack of resilience in some of the Labour Party. Under Jeremy, the feeling was that the press were the enemy. Now, that was sometimes problematic. The problem is the opposite is not necessarily true. Just because they're not the enemy doesn't mean they're your friends. And the party was not willing or not able to protect some of our own staff members. And I felt it was the only thing that I could do to protect staff members. And that is important for me. Some loyalty to staff members is very important.
Lloyd Russell-Moyle.
Yeah!
Mr. Deputy Speaker, on the 1st of December 1988, we observed the first World AIDS Day. In 2 days' time, we mark its 30th anniversary. And this event gives us pause to reflect how far we've come and to remember those who we've lost. But such events are also deeply personal to me. Because, Mr. Deputy Speaker, next year I will be marking an anniversary of my own, 10 years since I became HIV positive. The call from the clinic came and said they needed to see me, and they couldn't tell me any more information on the phone. I went to the clinic and they shuttled me into a counselling consultation room, and there they broke the news. I remember them trying to tell me, to calm me down, to say these things could be worked out. But at those times, you didn't go on the medication straight away. You waited, in fact, until you got iller. The single pill had just been introduced a year or so before, and HIV infections were only just coming down from their peak in London, which was the mid-2000s. And I waited probably about a year and a half, 2 years, until my CD4 count, the blood cell count, was low enough that they wanted to put me on the medication, and before they thought it would cause long-term harm to me. And I went on the medication, a tripler, one pill a night. It gave me some hallucinations very briefly at the beginning, but after one or two nights, that passed. I'm a HIV positive man, but because I've been taking the right medication for several years, I am what the NHS calls HIV positive undetectable. So undetectable means that the virus has been driven so low in your body that no test can detect it, and therefore you cannot pass it on. But we know it is there somewhere still, and the reason we know it is there somewhere still is because if you stop taking the medications, it comes back. So it is not abolished, it is not cured, it is there, but it is undetectable and untransmittable. You're not infectious, and effectively you live your life as normal. It has been a long journey, from the fear of acceptance and today, hopefully, advocacy, knowing that my treatment keeps me healthy and protects any partner that I may have. My view is that it's the duty of politicians to try and talk about their personal experiences and show leadership and example to create a more tolerant society. And no MP had announced ever in the chamber their HIV status. Only one other MP had ever been openly HIV positive in the past. And I would be the first ever MP to seek re-election with HIV. The second reason that I wanted to have this debate today is because we are genuinely on the cusp of eradicating new HIV transmissions in this country. Figures today show we are already, in parts of this country, halting the rates of HIV diagnosis. But we are at a fork in a road, and currently I worry that we might be starting to head in the wrong direction, with 700 million of cuts to public health between 2014 and 2017. We're not investing in the universal PrEP rollout, the pill that prevents HIV. And so I think it is important for me politically to speak out. The message needs to be, get tested. Get tested and get tested regularly. Whilst the initial 1980s adverts were good in making people stand up and listen, the problem is that it also created a culture of fear that you were going to die if you had this. And lots of human beings react by fear, by putting their head in the sand. And putting your head in the sand is a surefire way now of dying. There should be no fear. It is unpleasant. It's not nice. You don't want it. But there should be no fear about getting tested, because it is better to live in knowledge than die in fear.